From lightsabers and X-Wing fighters to bionic bad guys.
Commander, tear this ship apart!
And high-tech gadgets of every shape, size, and personality.
Will be destroyed for sure.
From the mind of George Lucas came an epic saga about a galaxy far, far away.
I'm gonna make the jump to light speed.
But just how much of the amazing technology seen in the Star Wars saga is actually based on scientific fact?
Help me, Obi-Wan Kenobi.
And how much is simply a Jedi mind trick?
There's a lot of elements in the movies that are coming to be true.
Could a lightsaber really work? And just how plausible is the science behind the world's best-known half-man, half-machine, Darth Vader?
Present technology is catching up with Star Wars and surpassing it.
So hop in your land speeder and get ready to take an incredible journey as we test the science fact and science fiction of Star Wars tech.
Here they come.
When you say the word Star Wars, most people probably picture gigantic spaceships shooting across the galaxy in a burst of digital surround sound. But while those huge explosions are certainly spectacular, how realistic are they?
In Star Wars, you hear a lot of sound, but actually in space, there would be no sound. Sound requires air. The reason you can hear me is because my voice is actually vibrating the air.
Space is basically a vacuum. Sound only travels through material, interacting with the air around it. So if you watch the ship explode, you wouldn't hear anything.
There is sound in space in Star Wars films, just to add dramatic emphasis to the shots. In a visual effects shot, sometimes sound effects actually sell the shot. Without the sound effect, it just doesn't work.
Big fiery explosions in space are another fantasy. Such a big explosion needs more oxygen than you would get from the limited oxygen in a ship, so fires would be much smaller than you actually see in Star Wars. And the ships themselves being hit would be presumably flammable. So the smoke that you get when they're hit, you would get whether you're in the atmosphere or not. So that's reasonable.
But not everything in a Star Wars space battle strays far from fact. Take X-Wing fighters, for example, the preferred craft of the heroic Rebel Alliance.
R2, that stabilizer's broken loose again. See if you can't lock it down.
With a few modifications, this sleek and speedy flyer would fit right in with the fighter planes found on our planet.
George Lucas looked at the X-Wing fighter as kind of an extrapolation of modern aircraft, jet fighters, and things like that. And I think that relationship, that it looks like a fighter plane, that people can connect with that. So you look at it and automatically people get what that is.
But the X-Wing would need a lot more engine power than our fighter planes to make hairpin turns like this in outer space.
In terms of maneuverability, you're out in space, so you can't use the atmosphere to generate any of the forces on you. An airplane turns and banks because it gets forces on the wings. In space, you don't have that to use, so you need engines that can send out in all directions if you're going to turn a lot.
You'd have to have a bunch of different thrusters mounted all over the vehicle, and they'd have to operate in perfect unison in order to get those kinds of coordinated turns. Those kinds of turns and movements, it's not really possible.
In battle, the X-Wings meet their match when confronted by the deadly Imperial TIE fighters.
Not bad. R2, see what you can do with it.
But here's one Star Wars technology that's a lot closer to our galaxy than you might think. The TIE in TIE Fighter stands for Twin Ion Engine, a type of engine that really does exist.
HYE, check hydraulic pressure, go.
Hydraulics, go.
In 1998, NASA launched a spacecraft known as Deep Space One on a data gathering mission.
Main engine start and liftoff of the Delta rocket with Deep Space One, testing the spacecraft technologies of the next century.
After launch, the spacecraft was propelled on its journey across the solar system
by a single ion engine.
The concept for ion engines has actually been around for more than 100 years. Now, the way it works is xenon gas, which is like helium or neon, but heavier, is introduced into a chamber here, and it's ionized, which means it's given an electric charge. And once it has an electric charge, a voltage applied between this grid and one just behind it causes the xenon to shoot out of the engine. Well, the action of the xenon going out this direction causes a reaction that pushes the spacecraft in the other direction. And that's how the ion thruster propels the spacecraft.
Ion engines are great for long space voyages that you don't mind getting there a little bit slowly. The problem is, while the particles have very high velocity, which is good, they have very low mass. And it takes a lot of energy to accelerate just a few particles, so we can only do a few at a time.
In fact, the ion engines that we use push on a spacecraft about as hard as this single piece of paper pushes on my hand. And so if you're being chased by an enemy who's trying to kill you, I think you'd probably opt for maneuverability over fuel efficiency.
Not only does the speed of the Empire's TIE fighters push the limits of current science, so do their large windshields, which can also be found on many other Star Wars spacecraft, like Han Solo's Millennium Falcon.
Sir, the possibility of successfully navigating an asteroid field is approximately 3,720 to 1.
Never tell me the odds.
It's very difficult to manufacture glass that can withstand the vacuum pressure exerted by space and also stand up to occasional encounters with floating debris. That's why the windows on real spaceships tend to be very small and up to 2.5 inches thick. But what if those windows weren't made of glass?
One possibility that's very exciting, that's a recent development, is a plasma window. Plasma is the fourth state of matter: solid, liquid, gas, plasma.
Plasma is like a gas that's been very electrified, so it has separated positive and negative charges. Like what's in a neon light, you have a tube to contain the plasma, which then glows and creates light.
Plasma has different properties than a gas because you have these charged particles moving around. They create electric and magnetic fields, and you can contain the plasma with electric and magnetic fields.
In 1995, physicist Adi Hershkovich did exactly that when he created the first plasma window. It was tiny compared to windows in Star Wars ships, only 2 inches in diameter. But it opened up the possibility of having gigantic space windows in the future.
Plasma, because of its density, can hold in atmosphere on one side and keep out space on the other side. And so it's something that could potentially work as a kind of force wall constrained within the boundaries of, say, a window opening or, say, the Death Star landing bay, and virtually be a wall between the vacuum and the atmosphere.
Another impressive feature of the spaceships in Star Wars is their ability to jump to light speed.
Strap yourselves in, I'm gonna make the jump to light speed.
Unfortunately, in our galaxy, spacecraft can't travel anywhere near the speed of light, much less beyond it.
In our everyday experience, we think, okay, if I wanna go twice as fast, I need twice as much energy. And the amount of energy you need to go a little bit faster, it's all proportional.
So going 4 times faster would take 4 times the amount of energy, and so on. Simple, right? Well, here's the problem. According to Einstein's special theory of relativity, as any object with mass or weight goes faster, it actually gets heavier.
The amount of energy you need to go a little bit faster just keeps getting bigger and bigger and bigger, and it goes to infinity, essentially.
The more mass you have, the more energy it takes to accelerate to a given speed.
You ready for light speed?
One, two, three!
To accelerate something with mass to the speed of light would require pretty much infinite energy. Currently, no known way to do this.
It's not fair.
The Millennium Falcon may have speed, but when it comes to sheer power, there's nothing that can beat the Death Star. In his original script for Episode 4, A New Hope, George Lucas envisioned a space station so huge it could carry fleets of TIE fighters, legions of stormtroopers, and hold enough energy to blow up an entire planet.
An international group of space agencies has been working on the International Space Station for many, many years now. It's microscopic in comparison to the size of the Death Star.
About the size of two football fields, the International Space Station might seem pretty big, but the Death Star's got it beat by miles. At 160 kilometers in diameter, it's nearly 900 times larger. And the Death Star's immense size doesn't keep it from orbiting planets or traveling across a star system.
It actually would have pretty modest propulsion needs since it's just in a normal Keplerian orbit, just like the Earth is around the Sun. It really would only need small thrusts to change its trajectory.
We're approaching the planet Yavin. The Rebel base is on a moon on the far side. We are preparing to orbit the planet.
But to get the Death Star moving fast or to make it change direction requires a tremendous amount of power, and that's something that's probably very difficult to achieve.
A more plausible feature of the Death Star is gravity. Because it's so huge, the Death Star has a certain amount of natural gravity.
There would be gravity on the surface of it. It would be detectable, but very, very weak. As you went toward the center, there would be less and less gravity. When you got to the middle, there'd be zero. So they would have to provide some other gravity field. You'd have to generate that.
So what would it take to let Darth Vader and his stormtroopers stroll leisurely down corridors while plotting to take over the galaxy?
One of the interesting things is that you can make a pseudo-gravity field by rotating the Death Star. If it's spinning on a north-south axis, centrifugal forces would be generated, and it would feel like gravity on the inner wall of the Death Star. The problem is people would be walking on the surface of the walls, so you'd have to turn the hallway sideways to make it look like people were walking on the floor normally.
So you could walk around out there. I mean, people have done the calculations. It's not that hard to make it spin that fast.
But for all its amazing capabilities, there was one thing the Death Star couldn't overcome, a fatal design flaw, one that allowed a lone pilot with a keen eye and the help of the Force,
let go,
to blow the whole thing to smithereens.
Light is coming in.
But although some of Star Wars' amazing technologies seem to be light years away from possibility here on Earth, others are almost within our grasp.
If you only knew the power.
He's big. He's bad.
I find your lack of faith disturbing.
And he's bionic. He's Darth Vader, the ultimate screen villain.
You are beaten. It is useless to resist.
He was born Anakin Skywalker, a clean-cut, likable kid with a talent for the Force, who grew up and lost his soul to the dark side.
Anakin, become my apprentice.
But that wasn't the only thing he lost. First, his right arm was cut off in a duel.
You underestimate my power!
Don't try it!
Then, after a battle with Obi-Wan Kenobi, he lost the rest of his limbs, suffered severe burns to his body, and damage to his lungs. Advanced prosthetics were able to keep him alive and turned him into the universe's most feared half-man, half-machine. But could anyone, even with the help of bionics, sustain such extensive injuries?
Can you hear me?
And survive?
When that happens, when he's on the edge of the volcano, he could survive that if he's in good shape. The burning that happened could actually help cauterize the blood flow, so it could reduce the loss of blood. The searing of the lungs, et cetera, could be lethal, of course. It's just a matter of how much and how poisonous the gas and the amount of heat.
The thing I would be most worried about would be his lungs, because breathing in that super hot air can burn severely. He seems to have continuous lung problems, and he probably had permanent damage to his lung tissue, in which case he would need some sort of purified, enriched oxygen to be pumped into his lungs.
Vader's breath mask was one of the first features George Lucas conceived for his character. The concept soon evolved to include the trademark black bodysuit that holds the key to Vader's survival.
Within the suit and the system he has to have sensors that access blood chemistry, amount of oxygen and carbon dioxide, how much sugar's in his blood, his temperature, heart rate, all those normal physiological things. Those are then brought in, and through the chips that are on his chest, he's got to then have an output to correct them in a certain way by raising temperature, lowering glucose, whatever it is.
Most impressive.
And what's even more impressive? The suit's combination of life-sustaining prosthetics and bionics really isn't that far-fetched.
Obi-Wan has taught you well.
Take that noisy air pump that allows Vader to breathe. A much quieter alternative is on the way.
To replace Darth's lung with a prosthetic lung, this sort of technology exists right now. We just take like a lab sponge like this, and we put it in the chest cavity. You notice that the sponge has got little holes in it, and you can put fluids in here and other compounds, growth factors. You can even have stem cells that migrate in here, and you want to reconstruct the same sort of layer that would be on the surface of the lungs. And this is being done right now. It's being done with a lot of different polymers. Even fat cells are being re-engineered.
In order to have a sense of touch and feel temperature, Vader's prosthetics would have to contain heat and pressure sensors. Another seemingly sci-fi technology that's currently available here on Earth.
We have some great prosthetic limbs now. Say you have an artificial limb, you grab a coffee cup. We now have sensors in the artificial fingers that are attached to your nerves up in your residual limb. And so if it's hot coffee, the heat would be transmitted and you would feel in a little plate the heat. If you are holding it too tightly, the pressure will make your limb tingle.
We would be honored if you would join us.
And in case you were wondering why you never see Darth Vader snacking on Empire cuisine, the Dark Lord gets all the nutrients he needs through a feeding tube in his suit. But unfortunately, Vader's purely liquid diet could lead to gastrointestinal complications.
One of the main problems with liquid nutrients, not a lot of bulk, a lot of fiber, and the internal milieu, the flora within the gut, gets very unhappy and it leads to sickness.
But what Vader lacks in a healthy diet is more than compensated for by his enormous strength.
What have you done with those plans?
And that strength gets an extra boost from a generator inside his armor that stimulates his muscles with powerful electrical impulses.
Right now, prosthetic limbs are powered with little batteries. We're getting up to the lithium battery, which is what's on your laptop. I think in the future, we're going to be powering the limbs with biological power through using the power of our bodies. They actually have an interesting biologically powered battery right now. It's about the size of a credit card, and if you urinate on this battery, that charges it up and it runs for a while. So one might think that perhaps Darth Vader, I don't know, may be charging up his batteries in ways we don't want to think about, but they're under the cape.
But of all the bionics used to put Darth Vader together again, the most impressive is the technology that went into the creation of his artificial hands. It's something that also benefits Luke Skywalker in Episode 5, The Empire Strikes Back.
Don't make me destroy you.
The hand is one of the body's most intricate structures, and Star Wars engineers have replicated its delicate dexterity down to the fingertips. And that technology is actually within our reach.
Present prosthetic devices have 2 or 3 degrees of freedom. They're just movements like this. It's how many movements. The ones that you've seen this year have about 4 or 5 degrees of freedom. What we need is 25 to do this, 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 this. So that will be coming out in about a year, year and a half. So I would say that what we see in Star Wars is very plausible.
On Earth, some hand prosthetics are controlled by contracting and relaxing residual muscles in the body.
The movement that makes it work is just in here. There's a little micro switch, and the slightest touch makes it open. The slightest touch on this side Basically, what I'm doing inside that cap is no more than that.
But to duplicate Star Wars technology, there's still one missing piece of the puzzle. Just how can the human brain communicate with something like an artificial hand?
The brain sends a signal to the residual muscles telling the hand to open. The computer senses that information from the residual muscle and the hand opens. Conversely, they can fire the muscles that would have caused their hand to close, and the hand can close. With some of the more advanced control techniques, we're actually able to alter the types of signals that can go to the microprocessor and change functions, make the hand do a pinch grip, or if you're holding a Coke bottle or something along those lines.
Fortunately, Luke Skywalker and even Darth Vader fared better at the hands of Star Wars surgeons than this fellow.
What's the situation, Captain?
A forerunner of Darth Vader, evil General Grievous became more machine than man after doctors were only able to save his brain, eyes, internal organs, and spinal cord.
Yes, Lord Sidious.
Grievous lost his arms and legs. At that point, his brain was still intact and was used to moving arms and legs. The question is whether you can take the signals that are already in his brain, take that intention and will to move, and turn it into action. We know the parts of the brain and the circuitry involved in some complex tasks, but the command signal, the output of all that brain electricity, what that really is, that code, we don't know that code yet, really.
Bionic technology is a continually evolving science. Each year brings us closer to the day when the interchanging of human parts will be commonplace. That constant evolution consciously influenced George Lucas and his effects team when designing the bionics of General Grievous.
Grievous was the alpha technology, but it didn't quite work. And so we tried to make him sort of heavy and clunky. We had him coughing and rasping, because we were thinking the technology wasn't quite working. His lungs were filling with liquid. But he was still stronger because of the technology. But it wasn't until the beta version, that's Vader, that he became stronger and was not restricted as much with the technology as Grievous was.
Now I am the master.
Only a master of evil, Darth.
But not even Vader was endowed with this bionic bonus, an extra pair of arms. And those added limbs gave Grievous a unique advantage over his Jedi opponents, an ability to wield four of the most elegant but deadly of all Star Wars technologies. The lightsaber.
What is it?
It's your father's lightsaber. This is the weapon of a Jedi Knight. Not as clumsy or random as a blaster. An elegant weapon for a more civilized age.
The lightsaber has been a key part of the Star Wars arsenal since the saga began. George Lucas envisioned it simply as a handle that shoots out a laser beam about 4 feet long. It's relatively lightweight and can cut through almost anything and everyone with one graceful stroke. The weapon of choice for both Jedi and Sith.
You're under arrest, Chancellor.
But could a lightsaber actually exist? Could a beam of laser light really cut through everything from flesh and bone to giant steel doors?
This is impossible!
And is a lightsaber blade even made of light?
Light is too insubstantial to accomplish what a lightsaber accomplishes. That is, you can't use light to repel an object, and yet lightsabers do that.
So how does a lightsaber's laser beam work? And what exactly is a laser?
Laser stands for light amplification by stimulated emission of radiation, which is a complicated way of saying that there are atomic processes that cause light to be emitted in a way that all of the light waves move together.
In a laser, there's an interaction between the atoms and the light. Rather than this light being completely random, going off in all directions and having all colors, photons in a laser can group up, and that will give you this beam which will have this special properties.
But in spite of their visual similarity, a laser beam can't come close to doing the kind of tricks a lightsaber can.
They crash into each other and clang. Of course, light doesn't do that.
At the end of the lightsaber, the light stops somehow. While in a laser, this beam will go on, practically speaking, forever.
A beam of light will continue unless it is scattered, absorbed, or reflected. There's no way a lightsaber would be a laser.
So when you think about it, if Yoda and Count Dooku swung two laser beams at each other, the result wouldn't exactly light up the box office.
If you have two laser beams crossing like lightsabers do in a battle, it's really no different than two flashlights crossing, and the light beams just pass right through each other and have no influence.
Okay, so lasers are out, but how else could lightsabers work?
Some people theorize that lightsabers use plasma.
So when you think about a plasma, you think about a glowing, gaseous-like substance. Stars are made out of plasma. The sun, lightning bolts, fluorescent lights, they're all plasma.
As we now know from our examination of the plasma window, this fourth state of matter is made of positively and negatively charged particles and can be constrained by both electric and magnetic fields.
On Earth now, we can make a cylinder of plasma. So you can imagine a tall, long tube of plasma, just like the lightsaber. Two plasma lightsabers would not cut through each other because the magnetic fields would repel each other. And plasma, when heated to a high degree, will glow just like the lightsabers do.
But in order to get plasma hot enough to slice through metal and people the way lightsabers do, it would have to be about 10 times hotter than anything found here on Earth.
Good, Anakin, good.
About 200 million degrees, actually.
Might just be better to mail it to your opponent, turn it on via remote control, and let him get a nice burn that way.
I see you have constructed a new lightsaber.
Another problem is the lightsaber handle is only the size of a flashlight. Right now, we could generate something that looks like a lightsaber, but it would take a building full of equipment to do it. So that's a problem. But if we can solve those problems, which I think, you know, in the future everything gets smaller, we'll be able to make something like a lightsaber.
But what about all those other high-tech weapons used by Star Wars heroes and villains?
Hokey religions and ancient weapons are no match for a good blaster at your side.
Star Wars lore tells us that blaster guns operate by firing concentrated beams of high-energy particles. Plasma has highly charged particles, too. So could blaster technology also involve plasma?
Blaster beams look like they might be made of plasma that's somehow been encapsulated or contained in a way to form a plasma bullet. This would be very deadly. You're sending something with a lot of energy through something and causing damage from the energy.
But finding a way to encapsulate fast-moving plasma to form a blaster beam has Earth scientists stumped.
These blaster guns, they shoot some piece of matter at an incredible speed. But if you have a plasma in free air, it will cool down and relax its heat to the surrounding air very quickly. I could not see how that could work in an atmosphere.
But blasters aren't the only weapons that can project concentrated blasts of energy in the Star Wars galaxy. Let's say you find yourself under attack by big guns.
Starting up the shield!
The handiest tool to have would be a deflector shield. And the bigger, the better. Believe it or not, Earth scientists are developing just such a defensive technology.
Bomb on fire.
But it'll be a while before they can make a shield tough enough to withstand a blast at point-blank range.
Plasma could potentially be used as a shield. There's a scientist now who's developing cold plasmas, because if you had a hot plasma and you put it around the outside of your ship as a shield, it would tend to melt your ship. But if it was a cold plasma, it could potentially protect your ship. It could deflect microwaves. It could potentially deflect laser beams. They're doing this now to potentially shield satellites in orbit.
In the world of Star Wars technology, it's possible for entire planets to have defense shields. But even they're no match for the deadliest of all Star Wars weapons, the Death Star super laser. The way the laser works can be compared to a magnifying glass when held under the sun. Both devices collect energy and intensify it into a single searing beam of light.
When the Death Star's light beams come together to make the super laser, in reality, those laser beams would just pass right through each other. They wouldn't combine. You can focus a single beam of light with a magnifying glass, but in the way the Death Star does it, it happens in empty space. That is, lasers come together and then go a different direction. And without some object there to redirect the laser beams, there's no way that could happen.
We didn't actually have a lens out there. George talked about how there would be a condenser of some kind or other, even though it would be invisible, that would bring multiple laser bolts together and be able to shoot at an object.
I have chosen to test this station's destructive power on your home planet of Alderaan.
No.
Commence primary.
So, once again, the Empire's R&D department seems to be light years ahead of anything we have on Earth, especially since our scientists have yet to invent a weapon powerful enough to blow away a planet with a single blast. But not all Star Wars technology is so deadly. Sometimes it can be downright fun, especially if you have to travel across deserts or through forests and cities at lightning speeds. From Tatooine to Endor.
Move closer.
And from Coruscant to Naboo. The need for speed seems just as essential to the life forms of Star Wars as it is for thrill-seeking motorcyclists and race car drivers here on Earth. Not only are the planetary vehicles of Star Wars incredible to look at, they also come fully equipped with more technological innovations than you can shake a lightsaber at.
I don't mind flying, but what you're doing is suicide!
Let's take Luke Skywalker's land speeder, for example. George Lucas described it as an auto-like transport that travels a few feet above the ground on a magnetic field. Magnetic levitation, or maglev technology, actually exists and is based on the fact that two like magnetic poles repel one another. Maglev trains use this principle and operate by moving a magnet attached to the train. The action generates a magnetic field which lifts and propels the vehicle down the tracks on a cushion of air. But how would maglev technology work on Luke's home planet, Tatooine, where there don't appear to be any tracks?
You could do that if the planet's made out of the right magnetic materials. Something like iron or nickel that have a strong magnetic response, your ship could generate a magnetic field that would then cause you to lift above that material.
But what if a planet didn't have the apparent magnetic properties of Tatooine? A place like Coruscant, for instance. How do the airspeeders of that world fly through the sky without wings?
Since these things seem to zip around just about any place and at any altitude you want, it'd require something that we don't have yet, pretty much anti-gravity.
We know about magnetism, charged particles attract and repel. So one might think I could get gravity to repel. It turns out within our universe, we know that you can't make gravity repulsive. However, you can look at theories of physics that are consistent within themselves and could contain other forces that would act like anti-gravity. So you can imagine in a completely different universe, you might get a force that can be repulsive relative to gravity, and then you could imagine using that as a technology to generate these things that float.
In the Star Wars universe, many vehicles use this notion of anti-gravity. George Lucas called it repulsor lift technology, which allows crafts of every kind to lift off the ground, hover, and even sail through the sky.
It seems like in the Star Wars universe, they have the power to manipulate gravity. If they can control gravity, they can make repulsor lift vehicles of any kind.
Using repulsor lift technology to fly above a planet's surface is one thing, But just how do Luke, Leia, and those nasty stormtroopers zip through giant redwoods on the moon of Endor without ever hitting a tree? Well, almost never. According to Star Wars experts, the answer to why stormtroopers are so quick can be found right under their high-tech helmets.
I was reading an article recently about guys who race on motorcycles. And they want helmets that are going to give them GPS data and data about the track ahead so that they can react more quickly.
Keep on that one, I'll take these two.
And I got the same thing going on the moon of Endor with those speeder bikes.
The stormtroopers weren't terribly bright. So they did have these helmet systems that helped them to guide the speeder bikes. They still lost out. The stormtroopers still crashed into things.
GPS-style helmets would also come in handy when piloting this high-speed Star Wars vehicle, one which uses a technology that can already be found right here on Earth, the Pod Racer. As built by young Anakin Skywalker, the Pod Racer appears to have Earth-style jet engines.
George described the Pod Racers as being like two 747 engines with the exterior covers pulled off, with this little pod behind it on these wires. He talked for probably 20 minutes, right off the top of his head, about the Pod Racer and about how it all worked. And the impression I got was that he was there yesterday at the races.
I remember trying to talk to George about the technology of those huge engines. Are they really like taking two 747 engines, putting some repulsors so they stay off the ground, and then binding them together with this electrical beam? And George's answer was, yeah, that's what it's like. I asked about the beam in the middle, and he said, well, the reason is because they've got this centrifugal force going on, this gyroscope going on, and if they weren't bound together like that, they'd actually smash into each other or head off like two magnets repelling each other.
Ooh, there goes Quadranero's power coupling.
Of course, as far as the forces of evil are concerned, speed isn't everything. AT-ATs, better known as Imperial Walkers, are a terrifying triumph of Empire engineering. But even though they can trample the heroic rebels on the planet Hoth as they do in Episode 5, The Empire Strikes Back, these behemoths aren't known for their quick moves.
When you look at these large four-legged pieces of equipment, it's hard to think of situations where they're a huge advantage over a wheeled vehicle because they would be, I think, a lot slower and a little more unstable.
Detach cable!
Fortunately for Empire engineers, their two-legged terrain vehicles, also known as chicken walkers, were much more practical, even if they were a little unsteady on their feet.
That one made a little more sense to me because it's walking around in the jungle, and you could imagine that you would need something like that in a dense jungle to move more like an animal or a person.
But sometimes the most sophisticated technology is still no match when pitted against one simple adversary, human ingenuity. Because as the old saying goes, the bigger they are, the harder they fall.
I am C-3PO, Human Cyborg Relations, and this is my counterpart, R2-D2.
Hello.
Since 1977, when the first Star Wars film premiered,
don't get technical with me.
Scientists and engineers have made great strides toward developing real robots that can execute many of the functions performed by the droids in Star Wars.
We need to operate quickly.
Using robots to aid in surgery is a very real possibility. One example would be telesurgery, where a skilled surgeon moves his hand, and at a distance, a robotic arm imitates his very movement. Robots are also wonderful for very small precision surgical work, as well as repetitive tasks.
Incredibly, robots are even learning how to express emotions, just like C-3PO.
I don't know what all this trouble is about, but I'm sure it must be your fault. You watch your language.
One area I think Star Wars was a real breakthrough was with the treatment of the droids. and the fact that the droids have personalities and emotions.
We seem to be made to suffer. It's our lot in life.
R2 and 3PO, here were two robots with personalities with lots of emotions.
And don't let me catch you following me, begging for help, because you won't get it.
And these emotions actually helped them.
R2, can you hear me? You must repair him. Sir, if any of my circuits or gears will help, I'll gladly donate them.
He'll be all right.
Emotions help us set priorities.
See if they've been captured. Hurry.
They help us plan and make decisions.
What does that mean? That means I am in charge here.
Researchers are making great progress in building robots that can emulate human emotions. As an example, MIT Media Lab's Kismet actually can carry on a conversation with you and make facial expressions based on your mood. They've programmed the responses in there so it will respond to your facial clues using motors and gadgets.
No.
Go? No, I'm not gonna go.
Yeah.
You're so silly.
The emotions that have been programmed into the robot have been modeled, computationally modeled, after what we know about human emotions.
I'm not
touching.
He loves
you.
Aw, did he say he loves me?
That's what I am.
Humans are super social.
And your favorite color blue?
So if we want to build a robot that can interact with people, communicate with people, and learn from people.
So like, look at him.
It has to also be social, because that's the way that people are going to try to teach it and the way they're going to try to communicate to it.
No, you're not to do that. No.
R2, that way.
But if robot technology is now taking big steps forward...
What's going on, buddy?
Another seemingly simple Star Wars concept is scientifically tougher to crack.
Put him in.
Carbonite freezing. Carbonite really does exist here on Earth. It's a type of gunpowder. But it doesn't have the same properties that it does in the world of Star Wars.
The way it's used in the film is kind of a dry ice with an opposite charge. Anything with ite, carbonite, it means it's some alloy of some mineral. So it's probably some carbon dioxide mineral alloy that is able to be kept at very, very low temperatures. Well, it's not ever explicitly explained.
But even though we haven't yet mastered the art of freezing and unfreezing human beings, scientists are working on it. It's a field of research called cryonics.
Cryonics is a way of taking a tissue and bringing it down to a very, very low temperature so there's no more need for oxygen or blood flow. And so what you have to do is replace the blood with glycerol. It's the same stuff we use in the lab to cryogenically preserve tissue. So you can get organisms, you can get tissue down, you can get a human down. The problem is bringing them back up. If you're warmed up too fast, you fall apart like peanut brittle. And then you just turn into goo.
You have hibernation sickness.
There's probably good science with the freezing of Han. The thawing, not so much.
I'm out of it for a little while. Everybody gets delusions of grandeur.
So when it comes to technological possibilities, it seems fair to say that George Lucas and his creative team envisioned a scientific galaxy that may not be so different from our own.
When people see something like that in a movie, it directly inspires them.
Help me, Obi-Wan Kenobi.
Because kids that are looking at that grow up to be professionals, engineers, scientists, that sort of thing. And they start thinking about that, and that's the way they want it to go.
All right, I'll give it a try.
No, try not. Do.
It shows how artists inform and tell scientists what's important in the world, and then we do it.
George Lucas's vision of this whole galactic civilization really excited people and really got them interested in moving in that direction and pushing those technologies forward.
Technology is really catching up with Star Wars in a bunch of different ways. It seems like many of these things are within our grasp.
Search your feelings, you know it to be true.
What the mind can conceive, scientists and engineers strive to make a reality. And judging from the advances in bionics and robotics to ion propulsion and plasma technology, perhaps the Star Wars galaxy isn't so far, far away after all.